I'm Vice President, Fire and Disaster Mitigation at the International Code Council, and I work in our Government Relations Department, and it is my pleasure to welcome you today, February 15th, 2022, to the ICC's Tornado Awareness and Risk Mitigation Webinar. Today, we've got a really great hour in store for you, and I want to go ahead and get started, and we'll talk a little bit about what you should expect today, and then we'll get right to introducing our panelists and then jump right into the program. So a couple of quick housekeeping notes for everyone on the call today. We are recording this session, so if you have to step away or you have any technical difficulties, there will be a recording of this session available after we finish. Materials from today's webinar are going to be posted on the ICC website, and everyone who is registered for this webinar will receive a follow-up email to the email address that you registered with that will have a link to our site that will also have all of the presentations from our presenters, as well as some helpful documents and links to some resources that you can use in your everyday work following the webinar. We encourage you to participate in the Q&A, so look for the Q&A button and participate in that. Send us questions and be active. We may not be able to answer all of them, but we will certainly do our best. And then just a quick housekeeping note as well, that we will stay on for a short time following the scheduled end of the webinar, which is at the top of the hour. So we're going to stay on for another 10-15 minutes afterwards, just to make sure that we answer any of the good questions that come in today and get to spend a little bit more time with you, since this is going to be a rapid fire session. So with that, I'd like to thank you again for joining us today. We have more than 1,000 participants registered for this session, attending from more than 13 countries around the world. So to say that we are floored by the response to this webinar is probably an understatement, and we very much appreciate you being here. Thank you for taking time out of your important days to join us. So with that, I'm going to jump right into our next slide, which is to introduce our distinguished panel here today. First and foremost, on the top left, I'd like to welcome Mark Levitan. Dr. Mark Levitan, he is lead research engineer for the National Windstorm Impact Reduction Program at the National Institute of Standards and Technology, or NIST. He's also a member of the American Society of Civil Engineers, or ASCE-7 committee. He chairs the ASCE-7 Tornado Task Committee, and was also past chair and chairs the ICC 500 standard development process. Next to him is my colleague Patia Scott, again, also a doctor. She is a civil engineer in the Earthquake and Wind Programs branch at the Federal Emergency Management Agency, or FEMA. She's an associate member of ASCE-7 and also an ASCE-7 wind load subcommittee member. Actually, let me back up a little bit. She's an associate member of ASCE-7's wind load subcommittee, and she's a member of the ICC 500 standard development committee. So I just wanted to make sure I got that right, Patia. Pardon me for the quick drop on that. Next is Donald Scott. Don is a professional engineer as well as a structural engineer. He is a fellow with the Structural Engineering Institute, also a fellow with the American Society of Civil Engineers, and he serves as senior principal at PCS Structural Solutions, and he is a member of ASCE-7 as well. You can see a theme here, and he was the chair of the ASCE-7 Wind Load Subcommittee. And next is my colleague, co-worker, Larry Novak. So Larry is a structural engineer, also a fellow with the Structural Engineering Institute, a fellow with the American Concrete Institute, and he's also a lead AP or associated professional. He is the Code Council's chief structural engineer in our Codes and Standards Department, member of ASCE-7, again, the theme, and also the ASCE-7 Subcommittee on Wind Load. So welcome to all of you. I am just about done talking here, but I do want to tee up the next slide, which is to get us to the background on why we are doing this webinar here today. There are many reasons, but really what prompted it was that Larry and I and Patia and some others had the opportunity to participate in a FEMA mitigation assessment team, or pre-MAT. And I wanted to talk to you a little bit about FEMA's mitigation assessment team concept, and talk to you just a little bit about why that's important for today's webinar. So mitigation assessment team concept was formed about 30 years ago. And when teams are deployed to the field immediately following disasters, those teams take a look at building performance under severe conditions, right? And trying to kind of figure out what happened during these big hazard events like tornadoes. The MAT also provides design and construction strategic recommendations for reducing damage, protecting lives in hazard areas. That's not just for FEMA, but that filters down also through the state where the disaster was and then onto the localities and all of the other stakeholders that are involved in disaster. So what's important about that is that Larry and Patti and I were members of a team of 8 folks that went out into the field in Kentucky following the deadly tornadoes down there prior to Christmas. So we deployed December 18th through the 23rd of last year. Our team split into 2, and we visited over 600 individual sites in 4 days, and then spent another day putting together a report and an initial brief out to members of the disaster team there in Kentucky, as well as in other places. So we documented trends in building performance. We also saw a number of storm shelters and places where either private site or community site shelters had really made a difference in the community. So we said to ourselves after that, I mean, it was a very moving experience, particularly given all the loss and the tragedy there, and coupling that with the fact that it was right prior to the holidays here in the U.S., we wanted to make sure that we carried that message forward, and we were going to do some more to bring attention and advocate for the wind-related provisions in the international codes and some of those pieces here today, and be able to tell that story effectively. So what I'm going to do next is I'm going to transfer this over to my colleague again, Larry Novak, the ICC's Chief Structural Engineer. And Larry's going to walk us through some of the information that we collected and some of the imagery that we collected on that pre-MAT visit to Kentucky, and then talk to you about the current state of play as it stands here with wind provisions and the I-codes. And that'll get us kicked off here today. So Larry, with no further ado, I'll give that to you and we'll move through your presentation. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you very much for the introduction, Carl. And thank you for hosting this event today. Next slide. What I want to do to start off with is talk about a little bit what we're going to cover at the intro part of this. I want to talk about the devastation that one can see at any tornado, especially if we saw down in Kentucky. And then we're going to talk about what's specifically in the 2022 I-codes, the IBC, International Building Code, the IRC, International Residential Code, and even the IEBC, the International Existing Building Code. Then we're going to talk about ICC 500, which is the standard for the design and construction of storm shelters. If you go down there to after the December 10th, 2021 tornado outbreak, it's kind of scary what one could see. What I want to do here is take a few seconds of silence and show you a video, and I want you to think about the devastation and the lives that were affected. And this isn't a case of this home or that home. This was an unprecedented outbreak of a wide path, of one of the longest paths also. Next slide. And this affected a lot of things, especially the emergency facilities. And the emergency facilities are very important to be able to have continue through an event like this, because they're the ones that come out and help those in need. And if their facilities are damaged or unusable, that makes it even harder for people to do things, or especially if the emergency people themselves are in ways having to get themselves out from under the disaster. So it's very important that these type of facilities have some continuation. Next. And large structures aren't immune either. That anywhere from a large facility downtown to a large industrial facilities, they can all be affected by these type of situations. And when these are affected, these are the places where people work, a place where they go to for help. And if these are affected, where do you turn? So it affects the entire community. And what we want is to build better communities. Next. You can even see here, single family residential. Some perform good, some perform bad. This can depend on where the tornado hits them or nips them, so to speak. But it certainly affects the lives of all those involved. The devastation, it almost can bring you to tears to see it in person. Next. And one of the things to keep in mind, when we look at these structures, we saw every possible failure mechanism, from roofs uplifting to the entire building lifting off the foundation. But we have some good stories too to tell. For example, the home you see in the lower right, which has a walkout basement. Well, he decided when he built the house, it would be just a couple extra feet to dig down into that hill cliff to get a walkout basement. Well, he's very glad he did, because not only did he go to the basement, the surrounding homes, residential around him, those people left their homes where they did not have basements and joined him. And every one of those people made it out safe and sound. So there are good stories. There are good places to go. And with today's communication, one knows where that tornado is headed fairly accurately by watching the weather. You can see the path and you know what to do. Next. So what can one do? Certainly basement's good. And for example, here, this was a reinforced concrete vault built into a downtown building. Sounds like a great place to go. And it probably was, but is it perfect? No, because even though it's reinforced concrete on all sides and top, the door was a standard door with standard door hardware. So the door itself probably is not designed for those type of forces that can be generated by a tornado, which is fairly astronomical compared to everyday type things that we think about. So yes, is it a great place to go? But is it perfect? No. Next. Now there are vintage storm shelters out there. This is a very interesting one, very near the path where it went through. And it was literally dug into the hill cliff. Nice, safe place to go. Is the door designed to the modern standards? Probably not, but it certainly is a great place to start. But is it perfect? We don't know. Because when these were done, they probably weren't done to a standard. And a standard defines minimum criteria. Next. What you see here is an example of a modern, I'll call it an ICC 500 shelter. You may also call it a FEMA 361. These are numbers that relate to a standard which makes these things designed with one goal in mind, preservation of life. They're not meant to be widescreen TV and you stay in these for a couple days. You get in these when the tornado's coming, it blows over, you can get out and you come out good. So they're very, very important devices. But to do that, to be number one in preservation of life, they need to be designed to a specific value and sometimes even tested. Next. Here you can see a back view of those. So what we saw before was the front door, and that front door is designed for these type of forces. And what if a tree falls in front of your front door? Well, in these particular ones, they have a back window, which you undo bolts and you can climb out. And if you look at the four corners at the base, there are anchors that go deep into the ground that keep this down to the ground. They're a complete load path for these tornado type forces. Next. So when we get to the I codes, one of the requirements of the I codes, simple starting requirement, a basic premise, if you don't mind me saying, is that of a complete load path. What do I mean by that? Well, it a system that provides a complete load path that meets the requirements for transferring the loads from their point of origin, wherever that may be, through the load resisting elements of the system to the foundations, and they're tied together. It ensures that you may still have a weak point, but there's no point of zero force where it can just easily come apart. It tries to ensure a complete transfer. And that's good for most things. Tornadoes are another level up where you need certain levels of strength. Next. So what type of things do we have in the codes relative to that? Well, we have those storm shelters that I mentioned. So one of the questions is, can I put a storm shelter in? Yes, you can permit a storm shelter. You can always add one if you want. So, and if they are to be done, they should be constructed in accordance with that ICC 500 I mentioned, which we'll talk more about. They can be an independent structure, or they can be within a host building, like a separate inside where everyone goes to get there in case of an emergency. So if you can do it anytime you want, the question comes, when is a storm shelter required by the IBC, the International Building Code? Well, we require it for critical emergency operations. What things do you want to be there and the people associated with those to be there to help you after a disaster? You want your 911 call center. You want your emergency operations centers, fire, rescue, ambulance, police stations, all those people that are there to help you. What else do we want? Well, we call it a Group E occupancy. The E stands for educational, specifically through 12th grade. Where do we send our kids during the day that they're there long periods in mass? We want those places to have some protection. That's very important. So those are when we do need a storm shelter. But those are when we're building a new structure. What if I'm modifying a structure? When do I need to bring one in? Well, the IEBC, the International Existing Building Code, says you need to add a storm shelter whenever your addition to that educational building in your school would hold greater than 50 occupants. Then we want you to build a storm shelter so that things get upgraded as upgrades happen to help out the long term. This is important to us and our communities. And one of the things I specified in here is that ICC 500 design, and specifically when ICC 500 says the wind speed is over 250 miles per hour, then these are required. Later in the slide set, I'll show the regions where that 250 applies so you know when this kicks in, so to speak, or is triggered. Next. What occupancy capacity do you need for these storm shelters in like that Group E educational? Well, you should include all the buildings on the site, their occupant capacity, and it should be at least greater than the total occupant load of the classrooms, vocational rooms, and offices, and or the occupant load of the greatest indoor assembly space. So what if everyone from multiple schools were coming there for a basketball game? We want to make sure they all have a place for safety. Next slide. But what about the IRC? We talked about big buildings the last two slides. What about your homes, your single family residences? Well, you certainly may add a storm shelter as a safe room internal or as a storm shelter external. But if you do it, it's not like you're building an accessory barn or storage shed, which some places, they don't even need a permit. If you're building a storm shelter, it shall be constructed in accordance with that ICC 500 standard I mentioned. It can be detached or a safe room, and a permit is required. And the documents need to be sealed by a registered design professional, like a structural engineer or an architect, indicating that it meets that ICC 500 requirements. If to avoid this being sealed by a registered professional, then all the components need to be listed and labeled to be in compliance with ICC 500. So ICC 500, if you get listed and labeled to that, it'll be on the item when you get it delivered. Next slide. So what is this magical ICC 500 I've mentioned 3 or 4 times? Well, it's the standard for the design and construction of storm shelters. It establishes the minimum requirements to safeguard public health, safety, and general welfare relative to the design, construction, and installation, has to be anchored to the ground correctly, of storm shelters constructed for the protection from tornadoes, hurricanes, and other severe windstorms. Their goal is life protection. So it's this standard is so important that it's not one that's created and then sleeps for a while and then gets renewed. This standard is under continuous maintenance, which means it is constantly updated to the latest information. Next slide. So I mentioned that these storm shelters for these critical areas and educational areas are required where ICC 500 indicates a wind speed above 250 miles per hour. I mean, think about that. You drive a car at 60 miles per hour. This is many times faster than even your normal car speed that this wind is blowing. And you can see it in the dark gray areas here. So you get as far north as Wisconsin, almost south to the Gulf, Texas, and then all the way over to the east. And these areas are important because they have a history of these high wind tornado events. So it's very important that we do this and we look at these and we obey and follow a standard.
Hey, Larry, I just wanted to jump in for a quick second and let you know, I know you have a few more slides. We are tight on time today, and I just want to make sure that we leave time for our other speakers to make sure that they're able to get all their information out. So we'll have to move forward on these. So are you ready for the next?
Next slide.
Great.
And that was the last one.
Very good. Well, thank you very much for that. And I appreciate all the insights there too. So that gives you, you know, not only a look at where we are in terms of state of play with the I codes, but also even more importantly, some of the experiences that we shared together along with Patia, who is up next here down in Kentucky, following those the tornadoes down there. So I think it's a great opportunity for a segue over to Patia to talk a little bit more about the FEMA programs and storm shelters. So Patia, with no further ado, you've been introduced, but great to have you here. Thanks again for the agency's support of this event, and the stage is yours.
Thank you, Carl. So I'm with FEMA, which is the Federal Emergency Management Agency. And in the United States, we're mostly known for response and recovery, but we also do building science work to mitigate disasters. And this graphic kind of shows that process. So we take the research and studies after events such as the recent tornadoes, we get lessons learned, and from that we develop guidance tools like our FEMA publications that many of you are probably familiar with. And then we have policies in place that allow us to attempt to use those lessons learned to get those best practices into codes and standards through the development process whenever we can. And after those are in there, we provide outreach and implementation of our guidance and codes and standards for hazard resistant criteria, and hopefully that leads to reduced disaster losses. Next slide. So like Carl mentioned earlier, one of the ways we're able to do the field studies after events is the mitigation assessment teams, which we call MATs, and also formal observation reports. And MATs go out after events to learn from building failures as well as successes, which we then turn into guidance tools and the potential codes and standards proposals. And our fieldwork in Kentucky was part of a pre-MAT, which is done quickly after a possible event. Just once search and rescues are complete, so we don't interfere with any of that, but before cleanup and the data is lost, because cleanup, we really can't learn anything if a bulldozer has cleared the area. So we try to get there out there as quickly as possible and then see what we might have learned from the event. And on the screen here, we have two previous MAT reports from the 99 and the 2011 tornado outbreaks, and then a formal observation report that we did on safe rooms back with the 2013 Moore, Oklahoma tornado. And you can use a web search and Google any of these or the FEMA MAT program, and these should pop up. Next slide. So Larry talked earlier about some observations from the recent pre-MAT, and I was on the other team that saw these two hardened areas that were used for tornado protection in Bremen, Kentucky. And in the bottom left, you can see the house was destroyed and the hardened area was left. The man that lived there said that his previous home had been hit by a tornado around 1979. And when he rebuilt in the early 80s, he had this shelter constructed by a local contractor, and the design was done by an engineer. And this predates the ICC 500 that Larry had mentioned, which was first published, I think, in 2008. So, but from what we can tell, this was built very well, and it likely meets a lot of the current guidance, other than the door, which obviously back then, they didn't have tested door assemblies required for storm shelters today. But luckily, the door that he did have held up because there were 16 people inside, and the man said that he let his neighbors and his family were all in there, and all of their homes in that area were actually destroyed. So it likely saved all of their lives. So they were very lucky. And then on the right there, that green egg looking thing is an in-ground structure installed in the early 2010s. It was across the street. We talked to a couple different people, which said that there were 6 to 8 people that took shelter inside, including the owner that lived in a mobile home that was completely gone after the tornado, and then his daughter and her family were in a single family home that was next door, and it was heavily damaged. And this little town only had about 300 people. So between these two shelters, it actually possibly saved 8% of the town, which I thought was kind of an interesting statistic. Next slide. So this was not a site that we visited, but it was an elementary school, and I kind of consider this a good success story. This is an elementary school in Kenton, Tennessee, which had a FEMA-funded safe room where many people from the neighborhood took shelter during this December 10th event. And based on the size, it had the capacity for over 700 people, but we're not sure exactly how many came on the December 10th. And it was in an area with EF2 level damage, but the note says that over 50 homes were destroyed in the area and no lives lost. So they sent us this very kind thank you. And I think it's a really good success story for a storm shelter or safe room. Next slide. This is FEMA's most popular publication, FEMA P320, taking shelter from the storm. We've handed out over 1 million copies. I'm really proud of it. So I'll just give a quick overview of it. We just updated and released it in March of 2021. It's primarily for homeowners, business, builders, and contractors. And the scope covers residential safe rooms only. The previous edition, if you have used that before, it did cover small businesses as well. But we wanted to keep it simple. And our other publication that I'll talk about later, FEMA P361 covers that. So we just kept this only to residential. And in this edition, we expanded the consumer guidance and added more information on prefab units. And it does not contain design criteria, but it does have prescriptive safe room design plans for concrete masonry units, concrete, insulated concrete forms, and wood frame with steel sheathing. And these plans are for sizes between 8x8 up to 14x14 feet, with a ceiling height of 8 feet. Next slide. And also included in FEMA P320 is this map to guide homeowners on what tornado zone they're in to help them decide if they want a safe room. And also the same contours of this map are used in the ICC 500 to determine the design wind speed. So if you look closely at the cities in there, like I grew up in Oklahoma City, so I'm well within the red area. And then you can see it goes as far east as Nashville and Cleveland, up north to Green Bay, and it's a pretty wide area that's this red zone that I think a lot of people are surprised when they are find out that they are in it. And this map is based on historical data where tornadoes have occurred frequently. So next slide. This is the other FEMA publication that I mentioned earlier, FEMA P361, Safe Rooms for Tornadoes and Hurricanes. It was also updated, and that was released in April 2021. And the note at the bottom there on the slide, the last edition was released in 2015. So this update reflects another 6 years of knowledge gained. And our updates follow the updating of ICC 500. So when the last edition came out in December 2020, we worked as quickly as we could to get our next publication out, which was April 2021, like I said earlier. And it covers both community and residential. And if you're not familiar, a residential safe room is 16 or fewer occupants and also serving a dwelling unit. And a community safe room is basically any other safe room other than that. And in this publication, part A, we have planning, operations, and maintenance. And then part B chapters, we actually follow the same organization as ICC 500. And we have detailed design and construction guidance, as well as FEMA funding criteria, which I'll talk about on the next slide. Our guidance in FEMA P361 is really similar to ICC 500. However, we use different terms to refer to them. They both provide life safety protection. And if a tornado was coming, I would take either one for sure. But a storm shelter meets ICC 500, and a safe room meets ICC 500 and FEMA funding criteria as listed in FEMA P361. And the differences between the two are actually in the appendix of the 361 document, if you're curious. We have a bit more conservative criteria to get grant funding, which is why we have the differences. And that's appendix B, if you're wondering. So not all storm shelters are safe rooms, but all safe rooms are storm shelters. Next slide. As of February 2020, FEMA has provided over $1.2 billion in safe room grants, which is nearly 26,300 residential safe rooms, over 2,200 community safe rooms, and that's in 26 different states and territories. So the second link there takes you to a list of, this is my favorite acronym, SHMOs, the State Hazard Mitigation Officers, where you can get more information about grants available in your area. And then that other link, the HMA Unified Guidance, that takes you to more information of how to get a FEMA grant. Next slide. So along with updating our FEMA Safe Room publications when the ICC 500 2020 was updated, we also updated our fact sheets that are listed here. And you can do a web search of FEMA Safe Room fact sheets, and you should be able to find these pretty easily. It's a little tricky with our website, but there's also a PDF handout, which I think will be on the ICC website for this webinar. So those will all be linked there as well. And I think that's my last slide, so I'll go back to Carl.
Well, and thank you so much, Patia. That was awesome. And, you know, absolutely, that will be linked on the ICC website. So for sure, come and visit that once this is over. And we'll be glad to have all that information for you and some more. So I have seen some good questions and some answers flowing back in the chat. So a reminder that the Q&A feature is out there. There was a good question in there, reference ASCE-7 design standards. Nobody better to speak to that than Mark Levitan from NIST. Mark, obviously I covered your credentials earlier, but I do have to put a personal note in here that I think we spent an hour and a half on the phone, and I literally got a master class that I know the rest of this audience is going to benefit from now here in a shortened version, but take it away, and I've been looking forward to this one all week. So glad to have you.
Great. Thanks, Carl and everybody. So I'm with NIST, the National Institute of Standards and Technology. It's a non-regulatory agency within the U.S. Department of Commerce. A long history of disaster and failure studies working this in our area. Next slide, please. So why haven't we considered tornadoes? Let me just say, I'm going to step back just a little bit, talk about the bigger picture and a little bit about tornadoes and tornado hazards and risk, and then lead into the new provisions that we have in NASC 7. But why haven't we considered tornadoes and conventional engineering design in the past? There's a lot of common misperceptions out there that tornadoes are too rare, that the losses from tornadoes are small compared to those in other hazards. There's nothing we can do about them. Inadequate knowledge. We'd all have to live in concrete bunkers or underground. It'd be too expensive. Next, please. But those perceptions may be shaped by the few violent tornadoes per year that make the headlines. Let's answer some of these questions in the next few slides. Next, please. Okay. So how rare are tornadoes? Well, according to the NOAA, we average over 1,251 tornadoes per year in recent years. And that's the number of reported tornadoes per year. Many tornadoes, especially in rural areas, go unreported. Now, you may look at that plot from 1950 through 2020 and see there's a big increase moving along and say, oh my gosh, we have climate change or something. And no, in the last 20 or so years, once we've had more efficient reporting technologies, the number of tornadoes is fairly stable. In the earlier years, what appears to be a lower number of tornadoes is actually we didn't have radar networks, we didn't have cell phones, we didn't have spotter networks, lower population, and so there's just less tornadoes that were reported. Next slide, please. So where do tornadoes occur? Tornadoes occur at many places around the globe. They occur on all the continents except for Antarctica. In the U.S., tornadoes we can see primarily occur east of the Continental Divide or east of the Rocky Mountain. This plot shows all of the tornadoes for a 22-year period. Recently, with the darker colors being the more intense tornadoes, the larger on the F scale or EF scale, that's the scale which we measure tornado intensity and tornado wind speeds. And you can see the traditional tornado alley in the central U.S. extending into the southeast. Some of you may be surprised that we have a lot of tornadoes up along in the northeast as well. So we can see that there, when we see later to talk about the tornado-prone region, we'll understand why it occurs east of the Continental Divide, right? That's what we're going to have to design for. Next slide, please. How many lives are lost in tornado? It turns out tornadoes kill more people per year in the U.S. than hurricanes and earthquakes combined, and tornado fatalities overwhelmingly occur inside buildings. Tornado fatalities is a buildings problem. Next slide, please. As we heard from others already, storm shelters are what we need to use for life safety protection. We can design for Mother Nature's worst. The FEMA safe rooms are designed for near absolute life safety protection. The ICC 500 storm shelters have almost identical requirements. They can and have saved many, many lives over time. There are no reported failures of safe rooms or shelters that have been constructed to FEMA or ICC 500 requirements, despite many of them being hit even by EF 4 and 5 tornadoes. Next slide, please. So how much damage did tornado cause? According to the Insurance Information Institute, tornadoes and tornadic storms made up about 40% of catastrophe insured losses over a recent 20-year period. Hurricanes and tropical storms only accounted for 38%. So tornadoes and tornadic storms cause a huge amount of losses. Next slide, please. Isn't most of the damage caused by the big tornadoes? Well, if we look at this plot on the right, and we can see we're plotting the losses for on the vertical axis versus the EF number, EF0 being the weakest tornadoes and EF5 being the strongest tornadoes. If we look at the black curve, we can see that the stronger the intensity of the tornado, we get a rapid increase in the total amount of damage. And by the way, this is on a log scale, and these losses are in millions of dollars, so these get to be big numbers. But what if we look at the EF1 and EF2 tornadoes? What if we look at the total aggregate losses? The total losses from all EF1 tornadoes are pretty similar to the total losses for all EF2, total losses for all EF3, et cetera. And that's because the total damage, so many more of these less intense tornadoes. In terms of EF5s, we have less than one EF5 tornado per year. So if we can do something about reducing the damage and the toll at the sort of EF0, 1, 2 range, maybe even up through 3 range, we can take a big bite out of the tornado losses. Next slide, please. So here's our opportunity for significant opportunity for tornado loss reduction. We don't have to design everything to withstand the most violent tornadoes in order to significantly reduce the damage. If your goal is to resist the most violent tornado, you put in a storm shelter or a safe room. But we don't design our other hazards for the worst possible event. We don't design for Category 5 hurricane in New York. Could it happen? Certainly, but it's a more rare event than we design for. We look at the bar chart on the right that shows 60 some odd percent of tornadoes are EF0, another 27% are EF1 of a total. About almost 90% of tornadoes, all tornadoes are EF0 and 1, and 97% or so are EF0 through 2. Additionally, most of the area impacted by an intense tornado doesn't experience the greatest wind speeds. For example, in the Joplin tornado, 72% of the total area, the total damage path, the total area swept by the tornado only experienced the EF0 through 2 speeds. Next slide, please. Okay. So the paradigm shift is needed here. Ignoring tornado hazards in the design of our built environment is clearly not an appropriate response. Next slide. So the genesis of the tornado loads in ASCE 722, we were seeing before examples from some of the MAT studies from FEMA. NIST also conducts disaster and failure studies. The result of our technical investigation of the Joplin tornado developed 16 recommendations for improving tornado hazard characterization, design and construction of buildings and shelters, and emergency communications. Next. So we're going to focus on the rest of the slides here is three of the recommendations. One, recommendation three, develop new tornado hazard maps considering the spatial estimates of tornado hazard. Recommendation six, develop tornado design methodologies. Recommendation five, develop performance-based tornado-resistant design standards. Next. Tornado hazard maps was a six-year process. Multi-year process. We worked with Applied Research Associates under Dr. Larry Twisdale. If you studied any work about tornadoes, you'll see his name across many of the most seminal and important papers on tornado risk assessment. And so we're very fortunate to have worked with him. Dr. Peter Vickery, well known to the wind community, are developing a lot of the work developing the wind hazard maps in ASCE 716, along with NIST. The U.S. Nuclear Regulatory Commission supplemented some NIST funding to look at analysis of epistemic or modeling uncertainties. We looked at a big deep dive into all the tornado data available. How do we account for the biases? How do we look at the improvements to the tornado wind fields? What are the actual wind speeds? Just because it says it was an EF2 in the record, how do we have a better understanding of what that really means in engineering terms? We considered epistemic uncertainties or modeling uncertainties, combined all of the analysis here into the hazard and risk models to develop the tornado hazard maps. We can and have done a day-long workshop just on the development of these hazard maps at ASCE headquarters. We did 2 day-long workshops during the development process, had a lot of stakeholders there participating, and stakeholder feedback was incorporated into the development of these final maps. Next. So tornado size effects, tornado risk and tornado speeds are a function of the building facility and size and shape. Tornado strike probabilities increase with increasing plan area. If we look at the picture on the bottom left, let's consider a geometric point target. So think of a freestanding communications tower has a plan area of a few square feet. The blue path represents, say, the idealized path of the tornado. But what happens when the butterfly flaps its wings in Brazil and the tornado moves over a little bit? It's going to move over a little bit. It's going to miss that geometric point target. But if we have a building, and a particularly a larger building, that tornado can move over, the butterfly can flap its wings a little harder, tornado can move over even farther, the building's still going to get hit. And so we can see there's a significant increase in the risk. What that means in terms of wind speeds is for a given return period or mean recurrence interval, like we use in the maps, the tornado speeds increase with increasing target size. Next. So here's some examples of the tornado hazard maps in ASCE 722 that we'll see. On the left-hand column, for risk category 3, we see 2 maps. The first row is for 10,000 square foot plan area, and the bottom row is for 1 million square foot, so a very large facility. We can see there's a huge increase, well over 20 miles per hour, and of course we square the speeds to get the pressures. So a very big increase in the spatial coverage of where the tornado curves even occur for the speeds, and as well as the coverage as well as the intensity. When we go to risk category 3, we can see the speeds increase. We have a series of map sizes in the standard, as well as we have an appendix with longer return period maps for specialty applications and nuclear applications. Next slide, please. So some other things we have to deal with in the standard is tornadic wind characteristics. They're very different for straight line winds and tornadoes. Tornadoes have a very short duration. They have rapidly changing speeds and directions. They have strong updrafts, the decreasing speed with height above ground, and they have atmospheric pressure change, which can induce loads. Next. So for example, one of the ways that we had to deal with all of these, and we made changes to the standard and to the parameters, we worked closely. In this case, we're looking at the decreasing speed with height above ground with the mobile radar community, these mobile Dopplers. We got there's not that many records where they have data very close to the ground, but there's a few dozen. We looked at all those, which are the light gray lines. And then the blue line, which is covered by the red somewhat there, was the median profile. And we can see that the median profile is generally increasing a little bit as it goes down to the ground, as opposed to what we see in the bottom figure, where we see the pressure for straight line boundary layer winds, right? The wind speeds decrease near the ground. And tornadoes, they increase near the ground. So that's one of the main big changes we had to make. Next slide. The tornadic wind structure interaction. For the short duration, we had to change the gust effect factor. For the changing wind directions and speeds, we had to change the directionality factor. For strong updrafts, we had a new factor to account for increase in uplift pressure coefficients. Next. So we did wind tunnel testing the wind basically has to go down the duct, right? So we can't really change and get an updraft in a traditional wind tunnel. But what we did do is we tipped the wind tunnel, the front face of the wind building, into the floor of the model to simulate the change in angle, the attack angle of attack for the wind flowing over the roof. And we got some coefficients to help us modify the pressure coefficients. We have also have atmospheric pressure change. We had to change our internal pressure coefficient to account for APC. Next, please. So now, how do we take all this science and engineering conducted by NIST and others and turn that into ASC 7 provisions? So I'll change hats here and take off my NIST hat and put on my hat as the chair of the Tornado Task Committee. Next. So again, our goal was to develop tornado loads, which were not in ASC 716, except for some information in the commentary, and bring those into the main body of the standard in 722. Next. We had to make a number of changes in the ASE7. In addition to the new chapter on tornado loads and this new appendix for the long return period maps, we had to make some changes to the general provisions, including tornado in the risk categorization table. We had to make changes to chapter 2 to add tornado loads into the load combinations. And we had to add requirement. We had a short requirement in chapter 26 that basically is a pointer that you have to go over to chapter 32 to check your tornado loads. Next. So what does our tornado loads look like? First page of our chapter here, and what are the kinds of things? Key facts about that is it's built on the ASCE7 wind load procedures framework. So it's designed to have a similar look and feel as the wind load provisions for ease of use. However, most of the coefficients and equations are modified to account for these differences in wind and wind structure interaction. Despite these similarities in procedures, though, tornado loads are treated completely separately from wind loads. You have to go through and calculate all your wind loads. If you have to calculate tornado loads, you don't always have to, but if you have to calculate tornado loads, you calculate all your tornado loads. You take both of those sets of loads and you go into your load combinations equations, and you'll have a lot of places you'll have W or W sub T, wind load or tornadic wind load, and you'll take the maximum of those inside those load combination equations. Next. In terms of the scope, the tornado load provisions apply only to risk category 3 and 4 buildings and other structures. So risk category 3, that's what? Places of assembly, schools, nursing homes. The risk category 4 is essential facilities, hospitals, fire, police, EMS, those sorts of things. It only applies to buildings that are located in the tornado prone region. We see the map at the bottom right. If you remember the map where they showed where all the tornadoes were in the US, that's, you can clearly understand why that's our tornado prone region. The other parts of the US, Alaska, Hawaii, Guam, Puerto Rico, other territories only have very small numbers of tornadoes, and they're typically with EF0, but they're also subject to hurricanes and typhoons and other intense storms, and so tornadoes will never control. So only east of the Rockies do we have to worry about that. And then we say we must resist the greater of tornado loads or wind loads using the load combinations in chapter 2. Next, please. We have a big user note. It's kind of like a caution sign right on the front page that you saw. It highlights some of the key features. It explains that the tornado speeds range from EF0 through EF2 intensity. So something like 60 to 138 is our map tornado speeds. Importantly, they depend upon the speed for your particular building depends upon three different factors: the risk category, the geographic location, and the effective plan area or target size. We saw that target size was important for your tornado risk. The return periods we use for risk category 3 and 4 are 1,700 and 3,000 years, the same as we use for wind loads. We're not designing for a more rare event. Options for protection for more intense tornadoes include storm shelters and performance-based design approaches. And importantly, tornado shelters cannot be designed solely using Chapter 32. Oh, we have tornado loads and I can use ASCE 7 to design my storm shelter. No, you still have to go to the storm shelter standard. There's many, many, much more stringent requirements that are in the storm shelter standard than are in the tornado loads. The tornado load chapter, we're designing for the common tornado, not the rare tornado, which are being designed for to protect for the storm shelter. Next, please. So where did we come up with this risk category 3 and 4 only and these return periods? We conducted a series of risk-informed analyses to compare the proposed tornadic wind load criteria with the reliability delivered by the existing wind load provisions that were in ASCE 716. This was done as a collaboration between the ASCE 7 Load Combination Subcommittee, the Chapter 2 Committee, and the Wind Load Subcommittee and NIST and Applied Research Associates. This was an adaptation of the reliability analysis that was used in the ASCE 716 wind maps. Our key finding here was the 1,700 and 3,000 year risk category maps for risk category 3 and 4. For those maps, the tornadic wind load criteria provide reasonable consistency with the reliability delivered by the existing criteria in chapters 26 and 27 for main wind force. So we can see then on the right, in the table on the right, for tornadoes for risk category 3 and 4, we use the same return period. At risk category 1 and 2, tornadoes are infrequent enough, they're rare enough, where the tornado speeds are so low that the loads would never control over the straight line winds. And that's why it's not a requirement. I will say, we get asked, we've gotten asked a lot already. Well, what about risk category 2? Again, these are minimum standards. I testified yesterday before the Illinois House of Representatives Committee looking into potential issues related to tornado safety. And they asked the question, is tornado safety, do you have to adopt that? I said, no, that's the minimum. You can always adopt above the minimum. You could decide for some local adoption that for certain risk category 2 criteria, facilities, you'd like to you have them apply the risk category 3. Next slide, please. I think we went next. Okay. Where is design for tornado loads not required? And we've seen that it's not required for risk category 3 and 4, for other than risk category 3 and 4. And if you're outside the tornado prone region, we also have some tests kind of shown in boxes 3 and 4 in the flow chart here. Basically, if your tornado speed turns out to be less than 60, then tornadoes won't control and you won't have to design. And if your tornado speeds for different exposures are less than a certain percentage of the basic wind speeds, it's pre-computed that the tornadoes won't control as well. So there is some ways before you have to go through all the load calculations, you may be able to tell if you're kind of on the fringes or you have a very small facility, something where tornadoes won't control, they have a few tests to be able to go through. So let's, next slide, please. Okay, so getting close to wrapping up here. Where are tornado loads more likely to control? Tornadoes are more likely to control at least some elements of the wind load design for structures that are located in the central and southeast U.S., for risk category 4, for structures designated as essential facilities, for those that have large effective plan areas, for those located in exposure B, low mean roof heights, and those that are classified as enclosed buildings. Where tornado loads are going to control the design uplift and pressures on the roof, that will typically increase the uplift pressures on the roof, which will help reduce our most common tornado and other windstorm failures. And tornado loads can control over wind loads, even when the tornado speeds are as little as half the basic wind speed. So just don't be fooled by, hey, the speeds in those tornado maps look pretty low. Because the changes in all those other factors, even a somewhat lower wind speed can give you a higher wind load than the basic provisions. And let's just look at two quick examples, and then I'll turn it over to Don. Next, please. So for the example, we look at a two-story elementary school with 100,000 square foot in exposure B, so urban, suburban, wooded. This is risk category 3. And what we've plotted here, anything that's in black or gray, you don't have to design for tornadoes. If it's in the white or the red, that's the ratio of the tornado pressure divided by the wind pressure for this particular roof, the middle of the roof. And so we go from white, just a little bit over 1, to the mid-reds. The peak in this map is about 2. So in some of these cases, we have an uplift in the middle of the roof is about 2. Next. So uplift pressures in the field of the roof are almost double for the straight line wind pressures across much of the central U.S. Now, the biggest increases in tornado pressures occur in the areas that already have the lowest magnitude roof pressures, like the middle of the roof or the leeward wall, because some of the changes affect atmospheric pressure change with the internal pressure. And that's an important component, but it's a small component compared to the other coefficients that are in there. Next slide, please. And lastly, one more example. If we look at a 5-story hospital building, again, we look at pressures in the middle of the roof, not on the windward edge. If we look at a large facility with 1 million square feet, any, if it's shaded, if it's diagonal lines, if it's gray or black, don't have to design for tornado. If it's in white or red, tornadoes will control the middle of the roof for this particular hospital up to a maximum of about 2.5. Now, we've picked some pretty extreme examples here, but and it ranges. It's, the important thing to note is it's very building specific in terms of how much the pressure will increase in different areas. So with that, I'll go ahead and wrap it up and turn it back to you, Carl.
Mark, thanks so much. Really appreciate that. And I know that was, no pun intended, a whirlwind tour of all of the great work that you've done here over the last several years and you and your colleagues have done. So again, I know we're running a little tight on time here today. For folks, we wanted to let you know that we did plan in some buffer time to run a little bit past the top of the hour. With that, what I'd like to do is turn it over to Don Scott. I know Don had been having maybe a little bit of technical challenge. He, like me, is traveling today for work and taking time out of his busy schedule and at the mercy of hotel internet. So, Don, I guess I'd ask you really quick, how are you doing there? And can you handle the slides? If not, maybe we'll bring Mark back and see if he might be able to punch these out and take us home.
Well, we'll see how it goes real quick here, Carl. Right now, it seems to be going okay. So, next slide.
All right, very good.
Okay, Carl, next slide.
Yep, I'm off the title slide for you now, so we're on to the second one.
Yeah, I'm not, there we go, thank you.
Yep.
And we'll, like I said, I'm having some internet issues, so hopefully they'll go along really well, but building upon what Mark had just talked about, and on, we wanted to give a couple of really what these provisions mean within ASCE 722. On a hospital, or excuse me, this is a elementary school study, and so, and a hospital study, but or that we looked at and said, what are they going to do? So a gentleman down in Huckabee Engineers down in the Dallas-Fort Worth area looked at a couple of examples, and you can look at the plan areas there, but about 100,000 square feet for the elementary school and about 1 million square feet for the hospital campus, same square footages that Mark just discussed in his slides. Next slide, Carl. And this will give you a cost estimate for the different square footages for the provisions. The previous slide was the main wind force resisting system. The final slide was the components and cladding, but here is really the genesis of the study. Is that when you look at for a
Don, I'm just punching in here really quick because some of these advanced on their own. I wanted to make sure what slide you wanted me on here really quick. So this is the first one with the comparisons.
You good?
Yep.
Okay. So like I said, having too many internet issues, so hopefully we'll get better here. But this is the main wind force resisting system comparison of the cost. And you can see this is for the elementary school, the fire stations, they're all listed on these bar charts here, or a hospital. And it looks at both ASCE 716 and compares them to ASCE 722 tornadoes. And you'll notice that the overall lateral force system for the main wind force resisting system are higher in tornadoes. This is for the high school and the essential facility, but really not very much cost-wise impact, and we'll talk about that. It's really mainly the uplift force that you're required to design to for your main wind force resisting system. So Carl, next slide. Okay, and the same study for components and cladding, the effective wind area there at 200 square feet, the same type of graph, not going to really go into it, but the zone 2 and 3 of the essential facility may increase your cost of your non-structural roof islands, but the zones 1 and 1 prime are where you do see, as Mark said, in the center of your building is where you see the highest uplift pressure increases. Next slide, Carl. Okay, there we go. Thanks, Carl. And I just wanted to highlight, when we looked at the additional cost of the tornado provisions, we looked at, a different exposure B or exposure C, elementary school or a high school, and you can look at them. And for your cost differential for exposure B, which would be the highest cost for when you're looking at tornado provisions, it's 0.24%. So not even 0.25% cost, total construction cost increase to apply these tornado provisions. So again, next slide, Carl. And so I did want to also address a few things that have been updated in 722. And you can see the list on the side. We're going to talk mainly about the maps and just a couple of other things that might make a difference in the tornado provisions. So, Carl, next slide. The maps, and the one thing that is nice about the new ASCE7 hazard tool, which you can look at the URL up on the top, the HTTPS ASCE7 hazard tool online, it's free. And from that, you can go in and find your site and plug it in, and you will get your longitude and latitude, and you plug that in, you will get all of your design loads from the one site. Now, I've just shown on the screenshot there the tornado loads for Moore, Oklahoma, and it gives you the design that you would have to do for a risk category for structure for this one when I chose that. Next slide, Carl. And elevated buildings, something that we have been long in need of within the standard. We have elevated buildings, and so as we apply these provisions to wind provisions and tornado provisions to these elevated buildings, we now have provisions to do that. Next slide. And one thing that was always a problem, or not a problem, but an issue in our ASCE 716, which is the diagrams on the right. Go back, there's Carl, please. Excuse me, on the left is the diagrams for 716. You can see how a lot of the zoning maps and a lot of different confusion there on the complications on how to pick out the roof pressure coefficients. On the right-hand side is we've tried to simplify those. These are the new roof zoning maps that you're gonna get for 722. So a lot less zones and a little bit easier to use on the pressure coefficients. Okay, last slide, Carl. And the one thing, just wanted to raise awareness, there is a performance-based wind design that you can use, and it's allowed in section 1.3.1.3 of ASCE7. I've highlighted the area there, but it's also referenced within the new tornado provisions that you can use performance-based wind design if you want to do that to help mitigate some of the issues that you might have with doing your design. So it's the direction we're headed in the future is performance-based codes, and it is allowed now. Thanks, Carl, I think that's it.
Yeah, you got it, and we were fighting the tech here a little bit, Don, but we got it done together. So I wanted to say thank you very much for working through all of that with us and invite the rest of our panelists to come back and join us now by video. This is where we'll be able to transition into the Q&A portion. I've been monitoring that as I've gone along, and I can see that our panelists have been answering a number of these questions as we've been going, so that's fantastic. But now I just wanted to give an opportunity for some conversation, and we'll kind of turn it back to the Q&A here. I guess I'd ask folks, is there anything in here that hasn't been addressed yet? I see there was just a question that came in, but maybe we as panelists want to take a look at that one and see who wants to take it. It was, let's see, that was on, are there going to be recommendations for retrofitting older buildings in urban areas? The question's coming from Chicago and they get tornadoes, but there's no place to put an additional shelter there. So who may want to take that? That might be wonderful. Patia, do you want to take that one really quick? Or Mark?
Sure. There are ways to retrofit buildings that have a storm shelter or a safe room. It is a lot harder than installing a new one, but we don't actually have a FEMA publication that specifically addresses that, unfortunately. But it is possible. So I don't know if Mark has anything to add on that.
Yeah, I mean, there's some of the private sector solutions that I've seen. If you have a garage, right, we've seen some that you can kind of bolt on down to the garage slab, or you may have to retrofit that slab to make that safe. So there is some kind of smaller other options, or some of them that you've seen that you can dig in below the floor of the garage, right? And other ones. So especially if you're on a first floor and can have access to good anchorage, there is some opportunities, or rebuild or install one inside of like a walk-in closet, something like that. So there is some possibilities.
Don, anything else to add there too?
No, I agree that we have to look for opportunities there. There's nothing specific within our codes and standards to give us direction on that yet.
Very good. I'm not seeing anything else come in here. Let me take a look. There might've been one that just popped in. So there was a quick question on receiving a participation certificate for today's class. This class is not for CEUs, and we will not be issuing participation certificates, but the materials, including the presentations, all the links, and a number of handouts will be available on the ICC's website when you receive that follow-up email from class. So, James, your question about please sharing the slides, that is the answer. You will certainly receive those by email once we're done here today. I guess I'd look to, we'll continue to monitor the Q&A. So if you'd like to put a couple in there for us, we'll take them live. But I guess maybe I'd like to go around the horn here really quick and say thank you to our panelists today for taking time out of their schedules. Again, I know Don's traveling and others are in a little bit more stable environment than he and I are. But, you know, maybe I'd just wrap it up by saying some freeform conversation here about kind of the state of affairs on ASCE 722 and maybe where you see that kind of heading in the future. You've got, you know, the 22 in the books. Where do you see that going? And then what maybe does the next development cycle look like for you all, since you all participated in that process?
I'm not sure. It cut out. Like I said, still having internet problems. But if you ask me that question to start with, we're, of course, the 728 cycle will be beginning probably in about a year from now is when it will start. And I see the thing that there's a couple of things that are really of high interest to people that are will be included in we're trying to include in 728. One biggest one is climate change. We're trying to develop some information on climate change. We're having a workshop in about 2 weeks with some climate scientists to develop, trying to develop some information on that to be inclusive within the standard. And then some more guidance on serviceability is probably the biggest item, the other item that we have coming up. So Mark and Patia might have different things to that.
Mark, we'll give it to you.
Sure, I would just encourage communities that are at risk from tornadoes to take a close look at these new tornado load provisions, and they may want to consider adopting them directly. There's certainly been precedent for direct adoption of a standard without waiting for requirements to show up in the building code. The state of Illinois and the state of Alabama both did that and started requiring ICC 500 shelters at schools, and even Alabama at certainly higher education, at university and college buildings. And those before any requirements that are over and above requirements that are in the IBC. So if you're in a tornado risk, we have the tornado load provisions now in the ASC 722 standard. And so they would be available for direct adoption by the communities as they need it.
Patia, we'll get to you here as well. And where do you think this takes, you know, where does the 722 and what you see coming for maybe the 728 development cycle affect some of the things you're working on there at FEMA?
Yeah. So I know we're looking into potentially using that for rebuilding, like after Kentucky, for some of the rebuilding efforts, but not a guarantee yet since it's so new. We're still in the discussion phase for that, so I can't really guarantee anything on that. And then for 28, since I'm just an associate member, I don't really know as much as Don would about that. So that's exciting to hear about the climate change input. I guess I could add, though, that we're already working on the next update of ICC 500, which Mark is the chair. So that's already begun and that would be, I guess, the 2023 edition, Mark, or 2024?
Yeah, 2023. I'm glad you brought that up, Patia. And the reason we did a short cycle is that we can include some of the great new science that we put into ASCE 722. We will update the reference edition of the ASCE 7 in the storm shelter standard to 722, bring in a bunch of the new tornado science. And then in future editions, when we go, so we'll have ASCE 728, we'll have a ICC 500, the next edition for the 29, and all those will be able to go together nice lockstep into the 30 building code. So we're also trying to get things aligned so we don't have this sort of mismatch where one edition of the storm shelter standard calls a previous edition of ASCE 7 that's different from what the rest of the building code is requiring, which we have sometimes right now.
Good conversation. So, Larry, I might pass it to you last just to kind of give a quick update on where we are with the ICC's process. I know that you have, just from our conversations, been working feverishly on code change proposals coming up for the Group B cycle and the hearings. The schedule is just out now, so maybe a little bit on the hearings coming up, those dates, and what people can expect in Rochester regarding code development. And you're on mute.
Thank you, Carl. Yep. Certainly the codes are always under development and advancement. We're currently in the cycle for creating the 2024 I-codes. The code action hearing committees on that are coming up, as you said, in Rochester, New York, right in the start of April, end of March. But certainly the key here is we cannot discuss or predict future code changes, but we encourage all interested parties to participate and get their say involved. And that's how we create better communities.
Very good. Well, that brings us, I think, to a close here, and it's a good endpoint. We hope to see folks on the call that participate in the development process in Rochester or participating how they can. For those of you that don't, you need to be engaged in the process, and that's what Larry and I are here for. And we're glad to, I think, have had this distinguished panel with us today to bring some additional light to the subject of wind provisions, particularly those surrounding tornadoes, and how they may impact the codes and standards kind of moving forward today, what the latest research is, what the latest science is, and why it matters. So this is all really groundbreaking stuff. You can obviously see the interest from our group in that. I would also say that there is a Building Safety Journal article that is being developed with interviews of all four of our panelists today to talk about this in a little bit more depth. So you'll see that come out here from the ICC, or you can visit Building Safety Journal online on the ICC website, and we'll be glad to continue the conversation with you as we have the opportunity. So again, Mark, Patia, Don, Larry, it's been a pleasure. Thank you very much for joining us. Again, over 1,000 participants today, 13 or more countries around the world. We hope you all got something from this. We certainly did, and absolutely enjoyed the opportunity to share some of this information with you. So thanks for joining us, and we'll catch you the next time. Take care, everyone. And Lisa, if you could put us back into a practice session here for a few minutes.